what we are going to do here is, if you will, not really enlighten the mood, but put a different twist to what we have been discussing. And what this panel we are doing over here is looking at the impact across the world of business and service to the work and encouragement that President Carter and Rosalynn Carter brought to this whole area. So by way of introduction, my name is Ajay Vinzé. I serve as Dean of the School of Business here at George Mason University. But today, more importantly, it is my privilege and pleasure to be with our panelists here and discussing, important issues, but issues that are a little bit different, issues that have impact on business, economy, society, and so on in a broader way. The conversation is a slightly different twist than the existing presentations, but let me first just start off by introducing the panelists. I've had the pleasure of meeting with the panelists on Zoom earlier, but we've had wonderful conversations, and what I've learned very quickly is they bring a whole host of experience and background that is very difficult for me to decipher and read from a script. So what I'm going to do is, as I spoke to them and as I was having my conversations with them, in my own mind and in my own way, what I decided was I was going to put labels on each one of them because that brings perspective in terms of where they're coming from and how they're presenting themselves. So let me start off by introducing Andy Shalal. Andy, I've labeled as a peace activist and entrepreneur. And he has a broad spanning career, and in his most recent incarnation, if you will, he's an artist, social entrepreneur, and a founder CEO of Bus Boys and Poets. And this is a restaurant which I haven't quite gone yet, but I've now researched extensively, which I plan to go. It's a restaurant group in Washington, in the metropolitan area, where art, culture, politics intentionally collide with each other, which is really a neat way of doing things. All this is done mindfully, over mindfully sourced foods, drinks, books, and event program. Fair to say?
What's that?
So that's Andy, and we'll give each one of them a chance to say a little bit more about themselves, but let me go on over here. Linda Matthews here, after our conversations, again, my labeling for Linda was, this is like a big coming out party. My labeling for Linda was that of a humanitarian focused on leadership development, team building, and resource mobilization. And she's the former CEO of the National Capital Region of the Red Cross, where she served at the local, regional, and national levels beginning from 1973. to 2020, and she has served on several boards, received numerous awards for her accomplishments in leadership development, team building, resource mobilization, and I can go on over here, but really looking at partnerships between public, private, and nonprofit sectors. So welcome, Linda. And I should also say Andy and Linda have the additional distinction of serving as co-chairs of the Advisory Council for Dean Albozerdam's our school. So thank you for that service. As a fellow dean, I can tell the importance of that role. So thank you for what you do over there. And finally, I wanted to introduce Bob Mitchell over here.
I'm too nervous for you to do this. I said I'm too nervous for you to do this. I have no idea how you're going to characterize
it. I looked at your thing. I got nervous. But it's part of the theme that we kept up this morning from an earlier conversation. Where we had the senator and his wife speaking. So we have the distinct pleasure of another couple over here, but looking at it from a very different perspective. Bob, I've sort of put a label of champion for bipartisan thought, which is so needed these days, especially. And that's not terribly creative of me, because presently Bob is volunteering as a founder president of a bipartisan leadership project. Having been an educator, business innovator, and I was reading through these wonderful accomplishments, but they've ranged from government sector to serving on the cabinet of Governor Blanchard, chief of staff for a U.S. senator, as well as heading an agricultural agency in Michigan for President Carter. So I will stop with my brief introductions, but what I really like is for each one of our panelists over here, and we can start, Linda, maybe with you. since you're closest right next to me, is to talk to us a little bit about your background, your interest in business and service as it relates to President Carter and Rosalynn.
Okay. I can actually say I've loved today the re-immersion in the life of Jimmy and Rosalynn Carter and all they've done with their lives. They actually did inspire my life later in life. I became connected with the American Red Cross really early in life as a kid. I'm grateful for the opportunity I had growing up in Memphis, Tennessee, segregated South like Jimmy Carter. And so I really was eager to learn and connect with community. That was really important to me early on. But, you know, the image I really love is Ann Holton's story about her mother swinging a hammer at age 80. You remember that image? I want to be doing that at 80. And I feel like my career with your American Red Cross has included metaphorically a lot of swinging the hammer to get things done, to involve people in getting things done. I've had a glorious career with Red Cross, 47 and a half years. I did wrap up to go on and do some more things, particularly to help develop the next generation of leaders who could lead in the context of this polarization and complexity we're living in. And so I loved what Bob was doing with the Bipartisan Leadership Project, and together our work led us to the Carter School for Peace and Conflict Resolution, where we initiated and are still involved with the Political Leadership Academy, in addition to some other things. I love the reference to Haiti, and if we have time, I'll comment about the work in Haiti. An image I have of work over the years was Haiti. I did go and was involved because the work of the Red Cross is all about alleviating human suffering in the face of emergency by mobilizing volunteers. And of course, we were involved in Haiti, although the story goes on, the need continues. And that's true for so many emergencies around the world. Businesses, I know we're to talk about the intersection of business. The work of the Red Cross is all about the engagement of individuals, people, human beings, as Alp talks about in his work, and businesses as partners, lending their employees and their resources of many kinds. So my heart, my head are filled with stories, and we won't have time to go into all of this. So let me invite you, Andy, to elaborate about your own life.
Maybe we can switch. Yeah, absolutely. Andy, if you would give us a little introduction of your background, your interest in this area, and more importantly, yeah, how you as an entrepreneur sort of cross-connect this
message. Well, I think most of us that get into this kind of interest, you know, being part of a community and volunteering and doing work, you know, really do is to kind of start out doing it for selfish reasons. You know, the idea that we all need to have joy in our lives. And I think being of service is a joyful thing. And I think it really does ground you into believing in humanity. I think if you just sit back and just watch and let things happen to you, you get very depressed and very upset for, you know. And I think for us that choose to be of service, I think we are much more joyful and much more engaged. And you have a little bit of, I guess, control over what happens in the world. You know, you at least that's the feeling you have, right? I remember when I opened Bus Boys and Poets, I was thinking at the thought of it happened right after 9/11. When 9/11 happened, there was a real difficult period of time, especially if you were Arab or Muslim living in this country. It became almost impossible, really, to feel connected or feel American. You know, many of us felt like we were not American. We were on the outside and always looked at with suspicion. And it was pretty awful times, frankly. And my thought is, like, there's got to be other people out there who don't believe that. America is much more than that. America is better than that. And the idea of opening a place that will bring people who believe in a better world was really important to me. I wanted to see them. I wanted to be in the same room with them, face them, look in their eyes and be able to kind of restore my belief in this country, restore my belief that America has a value, you know, that it stands for more than just, reacting to a horrible situation. So that was kind of really the interest that got me started into opening a place that brings community together. And of course, you know, Jimmy and Rosalynn Carter sort of exemplify that, I think, in the best of ways, right? I think so many people have said, he's one of the most underrated presidents we had. I think we're only starting to understand his value and how much we miss him today. If he was there, what would the world look like? It would look very different, I think. My connection to the school, I was there for a short period of time. I never finished, but I was here for a short period of time. But it was great to really be around people also who do believe that, you know, this kind of work is necessary, and this kind of work is tireless and endless. And sometimes we think we need to do something and get results tomorrow, but the advances we've seen today, whether it's civil rights or others, happened because of work that occurred 50 years ago. So sometimes you're doing this work because you believe that something better can come out of it, not necessarily in your lifetime, but certainly pass it on to the next generation. So I think the Carters for sure exemplify that kind of attitude, I think, toward life.
That's fantastic. And it would be great to hear more as we go through this conversation about how you as an entrepreneur sort of replicated the expectations of the Carters in some ways for what society is and through your restaurant and so on. And love to hear more about that. But maybe first we can have a little bit of introduction from Bob your perspective as a bipartisan specialist.
Oh, thank you, AJ. Pleasure to be with my two panelists. No diminution of your importance, but especially to be with Linda. So I don't know if you all picked up on that, but Linda and I are married. And it's the first time that we've been on a panel like this. So Dean Azadam, thank you very much for the invitation. I'm so impressed with the work that you're doing at the Carter School. It's just incredible that you've taken on so many fabulous activities. And it's exciting to be here. Thank you. And we appreciate this massive audience. each one of you are important, and we're glad that you're here. I have had the pleasure of spending time with President Carter, and for fear that I will be lowered in your esteem, I'm still going to tell you that the first time that I met him was in 1975 in the presidential suite of the Westward Hotel in Anchorage, Alaska, and he had just come from Japan, where he had participated in the bilateral meetings that were severely criticized by many people in this country. But he had the courage and strength and the interest as a potential president to become involved in what's going on in the world. And I believe it was Jerry Connolly earlier said that here he was a peanut farmer who was a one-time governor and walking around the nation saying, "Hi, I'm Jimmy Carter and I'm running for president." And he said that to me. And I was working for the United States Senator from Alaska at the time. And they had a lot in common, frankly, with policy issues. He joined us in Anchorage because we were organizing, had a large fundraiser to take place in that hotel later that evening. And I have to tell you that I found him to be so low-key. I would even use the term boring. I would say, you're going to have an impression of me that not very favorable to say that. But he was a remarkable human being that could lift himself from this very, very low-key. You'd never meet him and think, this guy could be president of the United States. No way. And after an hour or so, I actually excused myself to go work on the dinner that evening. and of course, later on, realized that that was a huge mistake and that I could have gleaned more from him. It's not that he didn't come across as bright, clearly, no question about that. But he just was very, very lucky. It was easy for me later in life, because I later, when he became president, I was chief staff for the senator. You could see that a lot of the problems that he had with members of Congress and so on, because he was so low-key. He wasn't a barnstormer, if you will, that invoked a lot of rah-rah support. He's just solid, so solid. And I later became an appointee of his to run an agricultural agency in Michigan. Great thrill, privilege to do work in rural Michigan. And the opportunities that I'm tempted to go into a lot of that, but it was incredible. Public service to me is the height of what we all can do. I worked for 22 years in government. The last 23, 4 years have been in the private sector. And certainly there's enjoyment and rewards and so on and so forth. And, the public service is just captivates my attention to this day. And as you mentioned, I spend a good deal of, all of my volunteer time and recreational time, et cetera, with Linda to promote a greater sense of bipartisanship in this country. It's desperately needed and thrilled to have an impact, and that we're doing some things with the dean and the Carter School that I think are making a dent, and we're on the verge of launching, and Dean will be talking with you about this either later today, tomorrow, but we now have a partnership with PBS Detroit to launch a 12 programs that will highlight public officials who, in fact, are doing it right. All we see in the media are politicians that are not doing it right and are fighting and putting each other down and using derogatory language toward each other and so on. There is a better way, and there are a lot of people who are doing it the better way. And so this show is going to enable us to highlight these people, and we're going to need some smart academia people to help support that show, and so we'll be talking.
As you can see, I mean, the balance, it's really quite incredible. I mean, your thoughts on three very dissimilar perspectives, but sort of bound by a common interest in having an impact on both decisional making as well as from a peace perspective and conflict resolution perspective. And as dean of the business school, one of the things I say ad nauseum almost is everything is business. There is a business of conflict resolution, and it comes from three different perspectives. If you from our board over here, you know, whether you take the political side of it, whether you take the entrepreneurial side of it, the not-for-profit side of it. So I'm curious, maybe Andy, we'll start with you. If you could talk to us about, you know, as an entrepreneur, what good words these activists in, and how do you see this translate in your work at Bus Boys and Ports? And
I think in entrepreneurship, people are looking for authenticity. They're looking for, you know, they want to see who's behind what's working, you know, and what they want to partake in. You know, this current crisis that we're going through in the Middle East was very testing for people in business. How do you react to something like this? Do you set your values in the corner, hoping that no one's going to notice? Or do you stand up front and say, this is something that I need to be in the middle of in order for me to, you know, uphold the values that I aspire to? So it was very interesting. We had immediately after the attacks on the Israeli side, then the response, of course, was you know, becoming very lopsided and very horrific on the other side as well. There was an interest in seeing that this is going to last. This is not something, it's going to be just a day or two. We decided that we've been doing these dialogues for many, many years. We call them peace cafes, where we've had Arabs and Jews and Israelis and Palestinians and others who are interested in a long and just peace and a long-lasting just peace in the Middle East to be able to come together face-to-face. We had been doing these conversations forever, since we opened Bus Boys and Poets, frankly, and before. We sort of stopped a little bit after COVID for many reasons that have been sort of trying to start it up again. So this was a perfect moment to have these conversations. So we put out on our website saying that we are going to have a conversation about this because we feel a conversation is important. We got slammed by so many people that felt that this is not the time for dialogue. This is not the time to speak. And of course, you know, that goes against everything that we talk about here, the importance of dialogue, especially during difficult times, you know, because this is something we're seeing unfolding in front of us. A lot of times, we, you know, we kind of look back and say, we should have, could have, would have, you know, done what we did. Now we can actually be in the middle of it and be part of it and be part of some kind of resolution that will limit the loss of innocence and life. And so, you know, having to be in the front and being able to do that and get the arrows that come from all different directions has been, you know, difficult, obviously. But nonetheless, you continue to push forward. You continue to, you know, we had people cancel their events that were having events at our place because we decided to have this conversation. It was really quite disturbing, frankly. And I think it's sort of the idea of shutting down debate, shutting down conversations is a thing, right? I mean, that's how fascism begins to grow, is when a lot of good people keep their mouth shut, you know? And I feel like public spaces, like a Bus Boys and Poets, like any public space like this, it is our duty, you know, to be able to say something right now. No matter what that thing is, you need to say something. Open up the possibilities of a conversation, of a dialogue. I can't tell you how many people said, this is not a good idea, do it now. The overwhelming majority were actually saying that.
And it wasn't a good idea to have the conversation.
To have the conversation is not a good idea. It's too raw. It's too, you know, new. It's too this. And I'm thinking like, if not now, when, you know? So I think being in business and entrepreneur, people say, well, you know, you're going to lose a lot of business. People talking boycotting, people talking about burning down the place. We had, on the day we had the event, we had to have police cars outside because of the threats that my staff got. They were really being uncomfortable being in a space that is being threatened with phone calls and emails and all kinds of things that were coming from every which direction.
Yes.
The dialogue happened on Wednesday, I believe. I think, which was like 3 or 4 days after the terrorist attack. This was going to be at my 450K location, which was in downtown. Yeah, which was in downtown. So, you know, obviously what I'm trying to get at here is that I think sometimes when you're in a public space and in business, you know, you have to figure out where you fit in, right? And the idea of, I think the key is just being authentic, because at the end, you know, the people that are gonna respect you and come back and be part of your world are going to be those who feel like this person is for real. He's not making this stuff up. He's not trying to win people or whatever because of business, for only business reasons, but really it comes from an authentic place.
That's interesting you say, you know, the key word you use is authentic, and that was the same word that, Bob, you mentioned about Jimmy Carter. I mean, you said President Carter initially comes across as boring in these overly exciting times. Boring might be a good thing.
That's right.
Vanilla.
I'll just bring down the temperature, if you will. But I'm curious, from your perspective, I mean, you lead up an organization that looks at bipartisanship and so on. And sometimes we look at it just from a political perspective. Over here, we're looking at it from a slightly different perspective. And implications of peacemaking or conflict, all this comes from two sides of it. And what Andy is suggesting is, you know, the lack of dialogue. So curious to your perspective on it.
Well, in preparation for coming here today, I try to think, well, what's the central point that could be made? And it's a little off the question that you just asked, but I'll try to come back to that. And that is that I think that for the most part, we do not realize the power that is available to an individual to make things happen. And certainly, Andy, you're a fantastic example of what one person has done. Linda's a great example of that. I've had an opportunity to see that, and maybe ways that the public wouldn't see that. But really, what one person does is just so impactful. Dean coming into this school and having, you know, his imprint and impact. And all of you in your various roles have these impacts. The program that we're running through the Carter School, and I say we, but it's really Charles Davidson running the Political Leadership Academy, is bringing together individuals who have diverse backgrounds, but they're learning and they're hungry to learn how it is that they can do better at resolving conflict. Sorry to pick on you, Al, but Al presented the first presentation to the group, this last group that we had. And I don't know how many slides you had in your presentation, 15, 20 slides. Al, in his hour before the group, got to, I think, the third one. And because there were so many questions, people were so hungry for learning about conflict and how to resolve it. And we know so little about it as individuals. So that's what's really exciting for me. Is to see these individuals and the impact that it has on them. And, well, the individuals have positions. Some of them are in public office. Some of them are not. But we have discovered and observed that each of them have an impact. And that's the whole idea.
And that is quite the balancing act that you have to do. And I think one of the things at George Mason that we are very proud of is, diversity. Yeah. It's not just diversity on the usual set of things. It's really diversity of thought, And are we going to promote that diversity of thought, or how can we promote that diversity of thought? And maybe what you're suggesting is those aspects that would be important for you. Then I'm curious from your perspective. I mean, you led an organization that's universally seen as peacemaker. How do you see this setting? How do you see the Red Cross or your experiences over there play out for at this backdrop with what we're talking about here today?
Well, my experience is that everyone, everyone has a way to contribute to peace building, peacemaking, response to a disaster, helping with the collection of blood. Everybody has a piece. I think Carter has modeled service, a life of service. And my strong belief is that everyone can follow his lead or follow what else is in your heart or whatever your motivators are, that everyone has the ability to contribute to doing good, to making a difference. And that's should be, is already to some degree, woven into every aspect of our life, the educational aspect, elementary, middle, and high school, and college. Even in Maryland, they've added a year of service between high school and college. Businesses, integrating the opportunity to serve into businesses. There's a business not far from where we are right now that has a very robust approach to engaging the employees and service to community locally, regionally, across the country, and nationally. So I believe we each have the ability to give what we have to give. And I think Carter said something a long time ago, give what you have, where you are, with what you have to give for as long as you can. And he certainly demonstrated one of the benefits is that you're going to live longer if you do and engage in service. We've heard people in the Political Leadership Academy express real interest in serving and an ability to serve even better when they're in a place where they can learn from people who think differently. We've heard many a testimony in the class about people who weren't sure they could, but came in and had an opportunity to listen and learn from people who think and are and have lived very differently. But once they're given the opportunity, be it in Busboys and Poets, where you do a magnificent job of providing community and time and space for people to learn from each other, or the classes, Political Leadership Academy, or on a service team through the Red Cross, there are opportunities to learn and from each other and deepen our commitments to service and making a difference.
This is just wonderful, and I can see the time signal of 5 minutes, but these are conversations that we need to have much broader. I think what this forum does is really starts the dialogue that, yes, we can go from it from a political perspective, we can go from a social perspective, moral perspective, but there's also the economic side of it. You know, you can look at it from a business perspective, and when business is brought in, you look at it not in a unidimensional way, but really look at it in a multidimensional way, as each one of you point out. So I would like to just ask you if you have any closing thoughts on this forum over here, or on what you have reflected on with President Carter's legacy or what have you. Some closing thoughts before we open it out. Over.
Well, I would just mention that my boss, Senator Mike Gravel from Alaska, was very engaged with President Carter on turning the Panama Canal back to the Panamanians. And the previous panel, they were talking about how Jimmy Carter was so hands on, fingers on, you know, to the details. And my boss was a little bit that way, or maybe a lot of bit that way. And the two of them worked beautifully together in bringing what I never thought was going to happen successfully to get the Congress to actually vote to to give something back to the people. It's a model that doesn't get a lot of attention, but it's really worthy of deep study, because the mentality in this country is that, well, help, we stole it legitimately and it's ours, and, you know, to hell with them. But here was a case where the right thinking actually won the day. This is not ours, it's theirs. We ought to turn it back. But...
And I think Mike Gravel really exemplifies a authentic leader, really. He was very principled, and I would dare say that's why he didn't win his second term.
It was exactly
why. He only served for one term.
That's not true. I ran his campaign that won the second term. He served two.
He served two terms. Oh, okay, all right. I thought it was one term.
Well, but in running for the third, he in fact became a victim, if you will, of standing up for his principles, yep, as it related to Arab and Israeli conflicts.
And Bob, as we're seeing, this is happening today. I received this is kind of campaign season, so I'm sure any of you who has voted anywhere has been receiving inundated with emails every single day, or texts about donating this and that. And one came to me from this person that I won't name, who is running for Congress for the first time, a young black man running for Congress. And he was standing with an Israeli flag behind him. And he said, vote for me, and so on. And he had pictures of himself in Israel, had gone on one of those trips that AIPAC oftentimes, mm-hmm, funds, and show you the side of Israel they want you to see when you come back. And I wrote to him and I said, what happened? I said, I worked with you. He was a very close fundraiser for Obama, and worked with him on many issues. I said, why just the one side? Why not present it in a way that is more humanistic, that's more open? And he said, it's much more complicated than you think, Andy. He said, let's have lunch when I get back. So the idea of sort of giving up your principles, because I know where he stands on many of these issues. He's really a fair person, mm-hmm, and would see the plight of Palestinians as being equally important to the safety of the Israelis. But he decided he doesn't want to say a word about this current situation.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, here's a guy who hasn't even started yet, and is already shedding off his values and his principles. What's going to happen to him once he's in there? And how is he going to last? And so that's going to take a lot of shedding. And I think that's what happens sometimes when people get elected. And I think Carter did not win his second election. He did not win his second term. But that we know for sure. I think he stood for a principled, president. He made his mistakes, no doubt about it. I mean, he had many, many issues that, I wouldn't agree with. But still, he was principled. You knew where he stood. You knew why he stood for it. It wasn't because of the money. It wasn't because of this. It was really because he believed something better. So I think that is maybe our takeaway. We need to get money out of politics is basically what we need to do. That's the takeaway.
I'm just recalling how you began this day out by mentioning that it was hope that this day and this event would cause us to recommit or strengthen our commitment to some of the values we heard talked about, especially those that enable us to be authentic in who we are, values of service, values of courage. Let's do this. Let's take advantage of this moment in time, this event, and the context within which we're having it to reconnect.
I just want to thank all our panelists over here. Wonderful perspective. These are conversations that don't just end at the end of the panel. These are conversations that start with this conversation. So I would encourage you to engage with our panelists as time allows you to. But thank you so very much for your time, and thank you, Al.
Yeah. Of course. Yeah.